So here with Nicola Keynes, the editor of the Brighton Indy, the Brighton Hove independent newspaper, available at over 200 stores in Brighton, out every Friday. And it's £1, is it? 50p if you get it in advance, Nicola. Welcome back. What's in this week's newspaper? I know that you've been watching Bake Off along with probably millions of other people on the TV. Tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, so Bake Off is back for people who love a bit of that. It's on Channel 4 now, obviously, 2 weeks in. And yeah, a bit of a spoiler coming up if you haven't watched this week already, but hopefully you have. So yeah, we've got a lovely guy from Brighton in this year called Jürgen. And yeah, he's originally from Germany, you can guess by the name, but has lived in the UK since 2003, lives in Brighton with his wife and son now. And yeah, I've been watching him closely. And first week, he was star baker in the first week. And then the second week, obviously, there was high hopes for him to perform well again. And he's actually was star baker again for the second week, which is pretty crazy. But yeah, he just seems to be, yeah, pretty amazing at baking anything they ask him. He seems to just smash it. And yeah, in this week, the second week, he did the showstopper at the end was fantastic. He did a big windmill out of gingerbread. The idea was like a kind of childhood toy that had an interactive element, and the sails on the windmill, you could like spin them round. Yeah, just it's fascinating, isn't it, what people can do with food. But yeah, I think he's getting a lot of kind of love out there on social media. And yeah, we've managed to obviously have done a piece on him and his performance on there, but have also managed to get a bit of background and a few kind of questions and answers from him about how it felt to get a place on the show and what it was like to see that famous kind of tent for the first time. So yeah, we'll have a nice piece on him in this week's Brighton Indy.
Yeah, what happens with, I'm probably the only person in Brighton that's never seen Bake Off. Do they eat all the food afterwards, or what happens with all of the food? Because I know on MasterChef, they only eat a bit of the food, don't they? So I'm a bit.
Yeah, the two judges, Prue and Paul, get to obviously taste each one to make sure it tastes nice. And sometimes the host's got Matt Lucas on there. They have a try as well. But yeah, I don't think they then. Well, I know you never see it. Maybe they do all get to eat everything after, but you don't really get to see that.
Right.
But yeah.
Right.
The judges are probably sick of eating when they've tried about 10 bits of cake.
Yeah, exactly. We should say there's a Brighton contestant on a RuPaul's Drag Race as well, actually, a drag queen from Brighton. I'm not sure if they're still in it, because they might have been one of the first people to be eliminated. But yeah, it's another contestant from the city. So that's good to see as well. Just tell us a bit about the theatre's reopening. I know the Brighton Centre is going to have a panto, isn't it, this Christmas. I think it's starting in November, actually, isn't it? So that's good news, isn't it? Because we haven't had a panto in the city for a while at the Brighton Centre.
Yeah, so, historically, there wasn't really a panto, was there, in Brighton?
Right.
And the Theatre Royal tend to just put on a really, really big show over Christmas, and they've got there's something about Jamie, haven't they, coming this Christmas time. But for the last couple of years, there's been a panto at the Hilton Hotel, and that company there, I think they're E3 Productions, those shows have got such a great response, and I've been to them myself as well, taking my children. They've been fantastic. So now it seems they've been snapped up by the Brighton Centre. And they're going to put on their panto at the Brighton Centre now from this year, which obviously allows for a much bigger audience. And yeah, they've got Aladdin this Christmas time. I think it's in December. It's from the 22nd of December, I think, until after Christmas. There's 10 performances in total. There's a couple of days where there's more than one performance. And yeah, it's Aladdin, and they've named Anita Dobson, the former EastEnders actress. She's going to be one of the lead roles. And yeah, I'm really excited. I'm going to take my children along to it. And yeah, it's just exciting. Another exciting thing for the city that we're going to have a proper kind of panto and Panto venue for the first time. So that's really exciting. And we've got a piece on that this week, as well as lots of stuff about other things coming up at all of the theatres. As I've said before, they're getting really busy now, aren't they? The theatres, Brighton Dome, Theatre Royal, Brighton Centre starting things as well. And it's just really good to see. And I don't know if I should admit it, but next week I'm going to see Jason Donovan at the Theatre Royal. He's only there for one night, but bit of nostalgia there. I'm really looking forward to that. I'm going with my best friend, so that's going to be a good night out.
Yeah, brilliant. And we should mention Pierfest as well. There's a lot of events going on with Pierfest. This month and next month, I know this week we've got New Generation Jazz on the end of the pier at Horatio's, which I'm looking forward to. I'll be seeing some of that. So Terry Seabrook, amongst other jazz musicians, playing there. So there's lots going on in the city, and we've just saying goodbye to the Labour Party conference as well, of course. So that's been quite interesting and good fun, hasn't it?
I've been using it as a chance to kind of go around to some local Brighton charities and things. There was a visit to the Volks Railway, obviously our lovely electric railway on the seafront, and some other charities and that have had some nice visits while all the MPs have been in the city. So yeah, that's been gone quite well from that side of things. So yeah, all good.
Yeah, just before we finish for the first half, Jabba's Day safe for tomorrow. I know that Bill Smith from Later TV and Angie Mariani, the singer, have been involved in that. Just tell us a bit about that. I mean, it's basically promoting vaccination amongst everyone, but particularly ethnic minorities. So it seems to have gone quite well so far.
Yeah, so, there's even a little appearance from yourself on there, Mark. So, yeah, all the lovely people down at Latest TV have helped the local NHS put together this video, Jab Today, Safer Tomorrow. Just encouraging the people who haven't had the vaccine yet to go along. Really catchy tune. Lots of kind of different people singing on there. And yeah, it's really good idea just to kind of keep that message going, isn't it? And trying to get it to people's attention that, yeah, go and get your vaccine. They're still doing them. They're still available at the Topshop walk-in every day. And I know the local NHS as well have really been trying to target all the students. So they were at the Sussex University last week, and then this week they're at Brighton University, just trying to get all those students that have maybe missed it to get their vaccines. And yeah, keep people safe and yourself.
Exactly. Just before you break as well, football, the Palace game, obviously Neil Morpay coming in there with a last minute equaliser, absolutely gorgeous goal. It felt like we won the game, actually, didn't it? So, fantastic. I mean,
I think a lot of fans, didn't they, going into that game, obviously really wanted the win because Brighton would have gone top of the table.
Yeah.
I didn't watch the whole game myself, but from hearing from fans that did go along, they said that Brighton, they weren't
brilliant.
Didn't look like winning. So the fact that to get a goal at 90 minutes plus five, the last kick of the game, wasn't it? To get the goal then and get an equaliser and get a point out of it. Like you say, I think lots of the fans felt like that was a win, and it was, great occasion. I've seen lots of the clips on social media of the Brighton fans who were there going absolutely wild with excitement.
Yeah, I think it was just the kind of the nature of the goal as well. You had that miss kick from the goalkeeper, but then Veltman kind of on the volley, putting a pass through over the Palace defence to Morpay, who just spectacularly lobbed the keeper. It was just a brilliant goal, wasn't it, to equalise? It was just like magic, really. Probably one of the goals of the season for the Albion, I would have thought already in the bag there.
Yeah, it was fantastic. Yeah. And obviously in the Brighton Indy every week, we have 12 pages on the Albion. And so this week we'll obviously have loads of reaction from people about that game and about the rivalry with Crystal Palace and everything. So yeah, make sure you pick up your copy this week because there'll be some good stuff in there looking back at that game and then looking ahead to the next game.
Yeah, puppy bucket list. Tell us a bit about the puppy bucket list as well.
Oh yeah, so this is a little Labrador puppy, 15 weeks old, and was picked up by RSPCA Brighton. We've got the lovely people down there in Patcham. They took this puppy in, and it was part of a litter, but one of them, this little one called Opie, was found to have some kind of heart condition. It doesn't look good for the little thing, unfortunately. So what they've, one of the foster carers has taken the puppy home, but she wants to give it a good life for as long as it can. And she's drawn up this puppy bucket list, and they're fundraising basically to raise some money so that this little puppy can do lots of nice things that all dogs like doing. So eating doggy ice cream, going on a picnic, entering a dog show, all those kind of things. So yeah, you can read more about that in this week's Brighton Indy as well.
Brilliant. We'll leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be back with Nicola Keynes, editor of the Brighton Indy newspaper, to discuss a lot more about local issues. Join us then. We're back here with Nicola Keynes, editor of the Brighton Indy, the Brighton Hove independent newspaper, and it is available in over 200 stores around Brighton. It comes out on a Friday. It's £1. Good value for money, particularly the Albion coverage, given that we're in a hunt for a European place, I'm thinking, because that's seventh place, by the way. European competitions are seventh place for this season, I think. So who knows?
I get so excited.
Yeah, well, you never know. You never know. Photos, Brighton skies. We've featured Faye Bridgewater on the TV before, particularly latest TV news. She's a painter. I know she runs the Brighton Skies Facebook page. You've been in contact with some of the contributors to that Facebook page, haven't you, Nicola?
Yeah, so this lovely picture behind me, if you can see it, and this was taken by Joe Bishop of Ovingdean. And yeah, I've been following the Brighton Skies group, and some of the pictures are just fantastic. I mean, obviously we live in a perfect place to get these beautiful sunset pictures, don't we, over the sea. But some of the photos are just, yeah, really brilliant. So what I decided to do was I picked out a couple, sent the photographers a message. And obviously not all of them are proper photographers, just people out on the beach taking lovely photos. Yes, I asked this one here, Joe Bishop, and another, if I could use their photos in the Brighton Indy. And yeah, I put them in last week's paper, this one and another. But what I'd really like is, I'll obviously keep an eye on the Brighton Skies group, but anyone who does take a lovely picture, if they want to send it in to me, that would be great. And obviously I'll put it in the paper and mention their name in there. And yeah, it's just nice. They get their photo in the paper and people just love looking at them, because it's just showing how beautiful our city is, isn't it? So yeah, if people want to email the pictures in, the best email would just be news@brightonandhoveindependent.co.uk. And if you can just include like a bit of detail about yourself, where the picture was and when you took it. And I know a lot of the fantastic photographers in the city are bringing out calendars, and so if you're doing that as well, let me know and I'll give your calendar a little plug as well.
The sunsets have been absolutely stunning, haven't they, as well, in recent evenings, and particularly the view from kind of the Brighton Marina looking towards Brighton Palace Pier. You can get some absolutely stunning photos if you kind of from that vantage point. So it's really, really worth going along the seafront actually in the evening, isn't it, to watch some of these sunsets. So they're really,
definitely.
Really worth.
And obviously we've got the I-360 as well, haven't we? And it's always lovely going up there at the time of the sunsets. And I know they've got some really nice events coming up there as well. They've been doing these gin tasting events, haven't they?
Yeah.
And they've actually got one soon, a Knightimber, lovely sparkling wine, which is from Sussex, which they serve on board anyway, and they're going to have a tasting evening for that, so you kind of get a little talk about Knightimber sparkling wine, and you get to try some as well while being up in the sky looking at the sunset.
I like Knightimber.
That sounds perfect to me.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, no, it's decent Knightimber. It's made locally as well, isn't it, in the Sussex area. So all right, bin strike. We've been following that as well. I mean, it does look like it's going to happen, doesn't it, the bin strike? Could be as early as next week, is that right?
So the first date planned was next week, October the 5th, I believe. Let's hope it doesn't happen, obviously, for us who live here. I know the council, the statement we got from the council, that they were pretty kind of determined that they wanted to have really positive discussions with the unions and try to come up with something to halt the strikes. Obviously, the council really don't want that to happen. But they, yeah, there needs to be a find a way forward to keep everyone happy and hopefully avoid all of us residents having a 2-week bin strike. And I think that would only be the first of it. And then they'd potentially do more later down the line, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
And then obviously there's just been, as well as the looming bin strike, there's obviously just been general issues with rubbish and recycling collections, which the council obviously apologised for, but there's lots of issues, isn't there, around staff, people off with COVID, recruiting agency staff, recruiting drivers. So, yeah, lots of issues around that. And I think we're all just keeping our fingers crossed that it can be resolved, really, aren't we?
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be interesting. We've had bin strikes before, haven't we, actually? I think the Greens were in power then in at Brighton Hove City Council. So it'd be hopefully it can be resolved. But I know speaking to Green Party councillors and other councillors, there are issues at the Hollingdean depot which kind of apparently need to be resolved. So I don't have any evidence of that. I'm not involved, but that's what I've been hearing. Jobs, new jobs, Amazon and the co-op at Patcham, the great old co-op at Patcham. People are recruiting. There's a lot of jobs, actually, isn't there? I mean, in the city available at the moment, particularly in the hospitality sector.
Yes, I mean, it sounds really positive for people that need jobs, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Obviously, that's really, really great news. But at the same time, I'm hearing lots of companies are actually struggling to recruit.
Yes.
So they're kind of putting these jobs out there, but not many people are applying. So, yeah, let's hope the people that really, really need the jobs go for these ones and get them. So, yeah, as you say, co-op in Patcham, they're actually having a really major kind of refit, £750,000 refurbishment of the co-op in Patcham. And I think it's due to open Friday, 1st of October. And it will create 17 new local jobs, they say. So that's really positive news. And then obviously last week we had the news that Uber were creating about 400 jobs in the city. And then now this week we've heard from Amazon and they've said more than 150 jobs, kind of, you know, like Amazon delivery drivers. And I should think they'll get quite busy in the lead up to Christmas, won't they? Delivering people's parcels. So yeah, plenty of jobs out there by the sounds of it, which is really great for the people that need it. So let's hope that let's hope that the companies that need the people to apply get those applicants in.
What about the fuel campaign? Because it's getting a bit chilly in the evening nowadays, isn't it? So that's going to be a big issue, that people struggling to pay fuel bills on top of everything else that's happened this year. It's not what people need, is it?
Yeah, so we launched a campaign last week called Keep Warm This Winter, and it came off the back of, obviously, the news that a lot of the energy companies were going bust. But just on that note, if your energy company does go bust, don't panic, because you do automatically get put with another energy supplier. But obviously the key thing is then to look at the rates and see if you can get like a fixed rate. So this is what our campaign is, really, is obviously calling on the government to give people a bit more support who are going to struggle with their fuel bills, but also just kind of giving people lots of advice and where to turn to for support locally, in Brighton, especially for us, where they can go and get the best advice to make sure their energy bills, they can keep them down. But also, if they are struggling, where can they go? Obviously, there's food banks. We've got something from the Trussell Trust this week.
Yeah.
They run all the food banks, don't they, across Sussex? And we've got lots of those in Brighton. And yeah, they're quite concerned that they're going to have more people coming to them, because not only with the energy price increase, there's also this cut to the £20 a week universal credit coming in as well. So they're saying with the two of those things together, the food banks are expecting to see another increase. So yeah, we'll have all the details of the places you can get that kind of support in the Brighton Indy.
Good to hear. Lastly, Vandy Gardens been nominated for an award. It does seem to have kind of worked, doesn't it, the Vandy Gardens scheme? I know there's a lot of criticism about it. Well, at least phases one and two, phase three hasn't started yet, and that's from the old steam down towards the pier. But the phases one and two are up for an award. It's quite a nice kind of park they've created there.
Yeah, it is really nice. It's nice to see spaces used for things like this, isn't it? And I think even during lockdown, lots of people even got into creating kind of wild gardens and stuff in their own back gardens. And yeah, we've got so many patches of kind of public space, haven't we, out there in the city? So I think they've done a really good job with that. And yeah, I think overall that the whole scheme it's a really big scheme, isn't it? Like you say, there's a third part still to come. But yeah, it's been nominated for a national award in the UK Highways Awards. So yeah, we'll see if it wins that for the city.
Brilliant. And once again, we can get the Brighton Indy over 200 outlets around Brighton out every Friday, and it's £1. Or if you do it in advance, you can get it for 50p. So get it while you can. And Nicola, thanks again for today, and we'll catch up again soon.
Thanks, Mark.
Cheers, thanks.